So here you have all these cameras. And the question is, why didn't I upgrade to the EOS-R from the 5D? Well, here's your answer. Got way too many cameras. Video over. All right, just kidding. So if you're new to this channel, consider subscribing, blah, blah, blah. You know what? Just hit that like button. That'll help me out a lot. Subscribe if you watch a bunch of my videos and you like that type of thing. So, all right, we got an array of cameras here, but we got one point. And the one point is, why did I not get the EOS-R, the Canon EOS-R, and I got all these other cameras instead when the EOS-R was definitely upgradable? So starting off with this story, as I empty this out, I'm going to pretty much start you off with my first DSLR camera that I got, the Canon 6D. The camera was awesome. Camera didn't have autofocus for video. The camera only had one card slot, right? And the camera was basically no frills, micro 5D. It had a pretty small screen, but it got the job done. I could actually turn this thing on, hello, for video, and it actually looked pretty good, you know? Autofocus wasn't really working for video. I've got this like 15 mil, that's not great, but it did the job. I could put custom firmware on it and it ran pretty well. And so this was my first DSLR and I thought, great, good start. So I wanted to record video, this recorded video, but this autofocus thing was kind of tough. Didn't record 4K, but at the time I wasn't into 4K. So great camera, one card slot, custom firmware. Awesome. But I needed a second camera. So my second camera ended up to be the Samsung NX1. Now I've got an adapter here to use a Canon lens, but I have plenty of Samsung lenses, which is what I'm using right now. I'm actually using another NX1 to record this. Haha, why am I buying so many cameras? Well, cameras I see for my type of business is an investment. I use this, I make money off of them, so they're actually worth it. So, okay, this camera, it has a tilty screen, no flippy screen, but tilty is better than no screen, right? And it's a touch screen. Oh gosh, I didn't put batteries in here, right? No, it's probably dead. Okay, it's touch screen. Touch screen works great. It records 4K 30 frames per second, 120 frames per second HD. It's small, it's pretty lightweight. It does have autofocus during video, which was huge because I had the 6D, which didn't have autofocus during video. And it was dual pixel autofocus, which was awesome as well. And I could convert Canon lenses, though none of the features like autofocus or image stabilization or any electronics would pass through. But the Samsung lenses I got with it were amazing as well, such as the one you're seeing. So, awesome camera and custom firmware on it too, so I can pretty much almost completely remove recording limits as well as higher bit rates and H.265 recording, which means better compression for that 4K. So the memory cards, and I have no memory card in here, but the memory cards on this camera can be super simple and they look amazing. So these were my two basis cameras. And I wanted to basically say, okay, I've got a APS-C sensor, so the sensor on this bad boy is slightly smaller, not sure if you can see that, but slightly smaller than full frame. So full frame was where it's at, Canon was where it's at, and I wanted another Canon color camera. So these were back in 2015. So then I upgraded to the 5D Mark IV. This was my money maker. Though there were other cameras that were coming out that were full frame that could compete with like great 4K and other things like that. I wanted the color science of the 5D. I wanted the rumored amazing autofocus of the 5D. And sure, it had cropped 4K, but it was still very usable. It still looked very good. The colors were very good. It had a touch screen. I was familiar with the interface. Dual pixel autofocus like the Samsung, but slightly better when it comes to face detect. It was just an awesome all-around camera. So it ran pretty well. Let me take this off. It ran pretty well. I like the fact that the interface, I can just kind of, you know, just move around with it and whatever. And the video features itself didn't have 120 frames per second in HD, but I had that with the Samsung NX1. This one, though, beat out those other two cameras because it had dual card slots, not just one, but dual card slots. So I would use both card slots, take amazing pictures, 30 megapixels, the whole shebang bang. This was my moneymaker and great. I use it a lot for YouTube videos as well. And if anything, since I bought this in 2016, I figured when a 5D Mark V comes out, I'm definitely getting it. So that was 2016, I got this camera. That's already three cameras that we've talked about, and it's not the EOS-R. So I got the GH5, Panasonic GH5. So I even got this, but still didn't consider the EOS-R. Now this I got in 2017, basically on launch day. And the reason I got this was for two reasons. GH5 had in-body image stabilization on this tiny sensor, like really small, Micro Four Thirds. And it had a flip screen. Just for those two things, I bought this camera. And then, of course, I got the option of recording log, which was amazing as well, which the 5D can do as well. But I wanted Panasonic's version of it too, because this seemed to be an all-around camera that can do it all. But, of course, the autofocus was abysmal, and even though I got a Metabone speed booster on it to reduce the crop, it still wasn't exactly all the looks that I wanted. Not exactly keen on getting this camera, but it still was a good powerhouse of a camera to get, and it did 4K up to 60 frames per second, 8-bit 4.20, I believe. So great camera. It did 10-bit 4.22 in 30 frames per second for 4K, which is amazing, and it had, of course, dual card slots, which dual card slots is money. That's what you need. Again, got this camera, but EOS-R wasn't even announced yet. If you notice a pattern, this camera and this camera were mirrorless. Lumix, Samsung, mirrorless, but nothing that was full frame, which was a shame. But they were worth getting at the time that I got them. My next camera wasn't until about 2019. I was avoiding all new cameras out there until I wanted 4K 60, but full frame. But this camera was announced. This is the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 4K. Now this is not a Micro Four Thirds sensor. It's actually a Four Thirds sensor. Let me actually show it off. Four Thirds sensor, so slightly bigger because the aspect ratio fits that of 17:9 format rather than a picture format. So it actually works good, and it's slightly less of a crop on video. But when you add the Metabone speed booster, which I purchased for the GH5, but it worked here, all of a sudden the size of the sensor looked a ton bigger, which is good because now it's like a 1.2 times crop, and it worked with EF lenses. So it was less of a crop than both the NX1 and the 5D Mark IV. GH5, since I could use that adapter, it was like the same thing. Now this bad boy I got because yes, it could do 4K 60 just like the GH5, but this moneymaker, even though it didn't have autofocus, the GH5 didn't have amazing autofocus either. But this thing could do raw recording to an SD card. Amazing. And that was later when they updated it. And it just has all these video features and easy to navigate menu. It just did it right. And because of it, and it's a real true cinema camera, though small, you get the quality on this is just hard to compare with. And it does raw, 12-bit raw, so you can do that. Adjust your white balance and ISO in post and just have a real moneymaker for a very cheap price. And that's why I got it, $12.95 as of this video. And it's just a do-it-in-one. Sure, no in-body image stabilization, but what cinema camera has in-body image stabilization? No continuous autofocus, but when you're filming cinema, it's probably best you use manual anyway. Though autofocus does have its place, it didn't need it, especially for this small camera, and very inexpensive. And the fact that, sure, no flip screen, but this screen is amazing nonetheless, really responsive and huge. And this camera was out when the EOS-R was already announced and pretty much released, but I avoided it. And I'll tell you why I avoided it. I'm bringing back the 5D Mark IV here. Now, the 5D Mark IV has a crop in the 4K. The EOS-R has a crop in the 4K. The 5D Mark IV has dual card slots. The EOS-R only has one card slot. The 5D Mark IV records 500 megabits per second in 4K, and a lot of people had a problem with that file size. the EOS-R records 480 megabits per second. So 480 megabits per second. It's almost the same, except it's H.264. This eventually got easy to edit with. EOS-R is a slightly smaller body with a flip screen. Great that you have a flip screen and digital image stabilization, where this didn't have it. But this could actually, I got a gimbal. I'll show you right here. I got a gimbal, and though it's not easy, I could film stable footage with a gimbal. So I had that for a while. And with this, and with this like hefty body, I could pretty much get similar, very similar image quality in my video. And what I wanted was an upgrade in image quality and what I can do with a camera. And this had pretty much everything that EOS-R has. Sure, the EOS-R had a flip screen, but you lose the dual card slots. And basically, and yes, you have digital image stabilization where you don't have it here. But the trade-off for another camera that's over $2,000 when I already have pretty much the image quality and ability to take photos on this didn't make any sense. So that's why I skipped the EOS-R, because A, I had all those other cameras, but B, the 5D is an EOS-R with different features, but still an excellent camera. And then eventually, this was worth upgrading to. I wanted the next 5D. This is considered the next 5D. A mirrorless 5D, the EOS-R 5. This gave me the flip screen. This gave me in-body image stabilization on a full frame sensor, though you can't see it because it's blocked by the shutter. Full frame sensor. I've got a crop sensor. I've got a crop lens on it. But this crop lens can be used to its full capacity when you switch this camera to crop sensor mode, and you can use the full, so then this camera will act like a crop sensor photography camera at around 20 megapixels or over 20 megapixels. So it's still great even as a crop camera, but then you could use it to full frame. It records, it's got a nice touch screen in the front. And no battery, of course. I come prepared. It's got dual card slots, CF Express and SD card. So it does that too, like the 5D. And it basically answered all my wants and needs when it comes to recording. Also, it records RAW internally, similar to the Blackmagic. So this one camera pretty much replaced all those other cameras' capabilities. RAW recording like the Blackmagic. In-body image stabilization like the GH5. 4K with no crop, like none of them do. Slow motion, like the NX1 was able to do at 120 frames per second, though this doesn't 4K. And pretty much the full frame sensor, like the 5D and the 6D, with amazing autofocus that completely replaces the 5D. This is literally all those cameras I just talked about in one. And that's the reason why I skipped the EOS-R, which was just a really similar features with slightly some less, some more than the 5D, but got the R5, which replaces all of those expensive cameras. Anyway, that's my story. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below. Definitely leave a like. You make my day when you subscribe today, and this is Magnus. We're out, but leave a comment, leave a like. That means so much to me, and keep the conversation going. See you later. Bye.